In 1977, the Atari 2600 was released to the public. By today's standards, this gaming system was pretty basic. But at the time, it was a huge deal, and would establish the gaming industry as a force to be reckoned with. Speaking of the force, 1977 also saw the debut of Star Wars. A New Hope was released to enraptured audiences and revolutionized Hollywood forever. Now, it may not seem like these two events would have much to do with the other. Star Wars was using some of the most cutting-edge and innovative visual effects that filmmakers had ever seen. And Atari, well, you could play Pong. But we start in 1977 because this was the year that set two industries on a collision course that no one could have imagined at the time. And in fact, it's only recently that gaming engines and filmmaking are working with the AV community to create worlds that were previously unimaginable.
If you go back to the beginning, when people first started creating computer games, it really was a case of no one knew what they were doing. You look at very early stuff like Pong, it literally is like, can we make it so this light on this side of the screen, you know, hits this other light and then it bounces back. It was a very exciting time.
As the 80s began, video games were still in a primitive state. In the pre-internet era, it was difficult for game developers to share ideas, and more importantly, programming code. So, if someone had an idea for a new game, they would essentially start from scratch and write code for everything. And when games were simple with two-dimensional graphics, this wasn't a big deal.
But over time, people try to do more and more complicated things, and gaming engines come about because there's a lot of background sort of tasks that are complicated that you need the computer to be doing that's the same every time you write a game. So it didn't take long before people started saying, if I'm going to write the same bit of code time and time again, I save that bit of code and I start from, not from zero, but I start from where I was last time.
Thus the idea of a gaming engine was created. If game developers didn't have to spend all that time writing code for background tasks, they could instead focus more time and energy on creating a great game. Meanwhile, following the success of A New Hope, the demand for greater visual effects in filmmaking was skyrocketing. And the most common technique for creating those effects was green screen.
Green screen or blue screen has been around since the 1940s. The challenge of working with blue screen or green screen is that the talent must now interact with things that don't actually exist. And the other major issue is the green or blue fringing that occurs when you're trying to do green screen. So depending on the practical set pieces or the costume, it could reflect the green or the blue environment in a very negative way that then has to be edited out in post-production.
Editing all those details requires massive amounts of time. And if something wasn't just right, you'd have to go back and reshoot, costing the studio more time and money. At the dawn of the 90s, the gaming industry was booming. Gaming consoles were now common household items, but there was one game in particular that would help birth the gaming engine's revolution.
But in terms of game engine development, nothing owes itself more than the development of Wolfenstein and Doom. It was the sheer excitement of Doom that broke the mold. It was the dawn of the internet, and it was the dawn of multiplayer experiences. And then they're going, okay, if people want to change it, rock on. Here's the code to change it. So what they're doing is they're distributing a game engine. They're giving away the technical expertise to make a game for free.
That's right. Rather than keeping the code to themselves, the creators of Doom distributed the game's engine, allowing users to make their own improvements and modifications.
It was revolutionary. It's the ethos behind it. Because again, game engines are about sharing code. It's about letting someone else use your hard work.
As game developers began sharing code broadly, the improvements in graphics and gameplay were tremendous. And in the late 90s and early aughts, the success of Doom inspired other gaming engines like Unreal and Unity, tools that allowed anyone to create three-dimensional worlds with incredible detail. The gaming engine's revolution had officially arrived. While green screen had become the standard in television and Hollywood, it wasn't the only technique around for creating custom backgrounds. Filmmakers have been using projection in their movies for decades, with mixed results.
So think about James Bond driving in his Aston Martin, and there's basically a projection screen behind him playing a recording of a car driving down the back of a road. So you're like, oh yeah, obviously James Bond's in front of a projection screen right now, and that's, you know, kind of kitschy.
So in 2013, the filmmakers of Oblivion decided to elevate background projection and take their set to the sky.
They had a giant projector wall set up around this glass box and all this sunrises and so on above the clouds. You can get this ambient lighting, which is just brilliant. And of course, especially the reflections. Let's say if you took the Oblivion house, which was made of all glass, just the thought of keying that out with green screen is absolutely ridiculous.
By projecting footage of clouds and sunsets on their background, the creators of Oblivion established a fully immersive set for their cast and crew. But what if you wanted to take it one step further? What if you wanted a fully immersive set for a world that only existed in fiction? A world that could only be created by a gaming engine.
Why not use the game engine straight in camera? And I mean, obviously the Mandalorian happened. They used those huge volumes and put the Unreal Engine behind it and started using the LED screen as an actual replacement for the green screen. So they actually saw what was happening in screen, and which was brilliant for everybody on set.
Over 40 years after 1977 and the debut of Atari and Star Wars, the creators of The Mandalorian used a gaming engine to transport audiences back to a galaxy far, far away.
Mandalorian was the first production to put all these different pieces really together. The goal was to be final pixel, that when they got the recording in the camera, the reflections were correct, the lighting was correct, and it was basically recreating a on-location type of shot in a volume instead.
Using a gaming engine for virtual production offers filmmakers limitless flexibility with their sets in real time. Changes that used to wait for post-production are now made by gaming engine experts on set.
It's just fun to work with, to be honest. One of the first tests we did was basically the moon surface, because it's quite easy to model. And then we had the Earth as an image back there. And the DP said on set, well, it's not really my thing. Let's move the Earth a bit to the left. It kind of was a ridiculous feeling at the moment.
Just like in 1977, it feels like we're on the verge of a new era in filmmaking. And as virtual production only continues to grow, the AV community will need to keep pace.
It's going to be very interesting to see what happens with LED and virtual production solutions combining with the power of GPUs and gaming engines. Will movies ever be made the same way again, or will we wind up having these enormous, ridiculous sound stages that can actually create an environment of your choice and not the snap of your finger?
Game over!
Many thanks to Brian Mikado, Adrian Weber, and Crispin O'Toole Bateman, whose series of articles on the history of gaming engines over at Ultimate Gaming Paradise was a huge help when writing this script. You can find a link to it and more in the description under this video. Oh, that's funny, because that's like a line from Paw Patrol, and I didn't even really realize it, but take to the sky!